In the last video, I talked about out-of-order execution method used in the floating point unit of the Athlon Classic. The reason why I haven't talked much about it is that it's a big topic that requires its own video. Now in this video, I'm gonna explain to you about it. Imagine that you're in a shop. You bought a small amount of groceries as you're thinking of eating out, like the one-third of Americans do. Now since you bought all of the required groceries, you are now waiting on the queue, which seems to be fairly small, that you think will take less than 5 minutes for checkout. But then, boom. This lady named Karen is shouting at the cashier because she didn't get her milk and will not move away until this guy fetches it from the store inventory. Now even though you bought stuff that would be billed total in seconds, because of her, you have to wait for some time. Another thing you would have noticed was the bagging part along with other staff aiding the checkout are just sitting there. She read it and Karen is done with the ramblings. This is relatable not only to you but for all the computer engineers. Instead of Karen wanting a milk, it's a big Karen instruction for the processor that requires a lot of stuff to work at the same time to get it done. But instead of happening once or twice a day, this occurs hundreds of times per second on a modern processor and it has to handle them all. Poor processor, if you ask me. Another thing is that because of this big instruction, other parts of the processor are just sitting there, not being used. You see, a CPU is not one big chunk of metal executing stuff, but a huge assembly line that executes information parallelly. Each part of the assembly line or pipeline is independent in executing information, except from the information that it gets from the previous one. This means that while one part of the pipeline is fetching the required information for execution, another part is executing a previous instruction fetched from the memory, and another part is writing the output of the previous instruction in the storage or memory which is already executed. Now imagine all of these parts just sitting there, doing nothing. Since some fat instruction wants all of this information fetched and each one of them to be executed, this is a major efficiency flaw. This is what a traditional processor did. Now let us see what an out-of-order execution supported processor does. Hey, just a note, from now on, we'll just call it out-of-order execution instead of the mouthful. Out-of-order execution. Okay, here we go. An out-of-order execution architecture solves it by a simple change to the processor. Instead of executing an instruction straight on a queue, there's another queue where the heavy instructions are put. But wait, instead of just putting all the instructions in a queue and calling it quits, the processor checks periodically whether all the requirements for the particular instruction are met and then execute it. This means that instead of all of the processor stalling for that one heavy instruction to get its requirement filled on, it is pushed away to make way for the small instructions until the requirement for the heavy instruction is met. Out-of-order execution-based computers were introduced way before their mass commercialization. The first out-of-order execution-based computers were the CDC 6000 family, which was released on 1964. It had a scoreboarding system, which was like a proto-out-of-order execution algorithm. The first two architecture based on out-of-order execution was the IBM System 360 Model 91, which used the Tomasello's algorithm, a really powerful algorithm in its own video, to achieve out-of-order execution. And by the 1990s, out-of-order execution was found in all of the microprocessors, with only several processors like the Intel Itanium, which could not offer the large amount of die area required for this type of architecture. The current problem with out-of-order execution mechanisms is that certain implementations of it can be exploited by hackers. This vulnerability in the system that was exploited is known as the infamous Spectre and Meltdown. Though the vulnerability in question was fixed and you don't have to worry about Sarah having a powerful self-replicating keylogger on a computer to make the next Skynet and destroy the world and steal your password, this vulnerability shows that the design for the processor must be, you know, cautious. This method is one of the core architecture components that the processor had. Hey, if you like the video, subscribe. No pressure or anything. I just need friends.